what is composition scheme, who is eligible for composition scheme, category of people who are not eligible or excluded from composition scheme, composition rate at which the taxes have to be computed and paid, and the procedure which a composition dealer has to follow. Similarly, in accounts and records, we will be going through what are the records which are to be maintained by a regular taxpayer, what are the records which are required to be maintained by a composition dealer, the period for which these records are to be maintained, can these records be maintained electronically as well as manually, and so on and so forth. We are hopeful that by the end of the session, we would have cleared all the doubts in your minds on both the subjects. Composition levy is essentially in the nature of a turnover levy at a small rate which applies to composition dealers. By nature, it being a turnover levy, it presents a few inherent advantages. The first advantage is that the rate at which it gets taxed on appearance is low, but I'll go into the details of how this rate does collect appropriate tax which needs to be collected. The procedure of compliance is hassle-free. The return is simple. The periodicity with which the return is to be filed or the taxes are to be paid is lesser than a regular taxpayer. The calculation of tax is based on turnover. And the return, as I explained, is quarterly. Who does composition scheme apply to? A composition scheme can be availed by a manufacturer, excluding a small category, which I will shortly explain. It can be availed by a trader, and within the services, only service where it can be availed is a restaurant. The turnover limit in the last financial year is 75 lakhs, which means if in the last financial year your turnover was 75 lakhs or less, you are eligible to composition scheme. There are certain conditions and restrictions to avail this scheme besides this threshold, which I will explain as we go along in the presentation. As far as special category states are concerned, there are 11 of them. For 9 of them, the composition threshold limit is 50 lakhs. They are Assam, Meghalaya, Manipur, Arunachal Pradesh, Mizoram, Tripura, Nagaland, Sikkim, and Himachal Pradesh. Two special category states, namely Uttarakhand and J&K, have opted to keep the composition scheme threshold at 75 lakhs. Now, this 75 lakhs threshold or 50 lakhs threshold, how it is to be computed? The computation for threshold in GST in general and composition scheme also is on all India basis. That means on a given pan, if a composition dealer has multiple outfits in multiple states, the turnover of all of them will be clubbed together, and if they collectively are below 75 lakhs, then the deal for each of those outlets in all these states, the composition benefit will become available. The total turnover includes exempt supplies which have been made, as well as the exports which are, as it includes the value of exempt supplies as well as exports, but I don't think exports is the correct presentation here. It does not include the GST paid and the value of supplies received by the person on which he pays tax on reverse charge basis. What it means is when the composition dealer buys certain goods from an unregistered person, then he has to pay like any other taxpayer tax on reverse charge basis. Now, this turnover, whether it should be added for the purposes of arriving at the composition limit or not, the answer is this is not a supply which he is making, and though he will be paying tax on these supplies, this will not get included in the calculation of turnover which the composition dealer has to calculate. Now, composition scheme cannot be availed if there are multiple outlets in multiple states selectively in one of them. When composition scheme is availed, all registered persons on that PAN would become included in the composition scheme. Declaration in relation to one will amount to declaration in relation to all. And similarly, when you withdraw, withdrawal in relation to one shall amount to withdrawal in relation to all, and the procedures will apply. When the person crosses the threshold, let us say from the month of March he starts making supplies under composition scheme, and sometimes in the month of December he crosses the threshold, then post December he no longer is eligible to composition scheme. On crossing the threshold, composition benefit comes to an end, and thereafter he has to start behaving like a normal taxpayer, pay his taxes normally, file his return normally. So composition is essentially for people with small turnover below 75 lakhs. The next question is, how do composition taxes get calculated? What is the rate at which composition tax is to be paid? There are three categories, as I explained, to whom composition scheme is available: manufacturers, traders, and restaurants. Manufacturers would be paying tax at 2%, which is 1% SGST and 1% CGST. Traders will be paying tax at the rate of 1%, that means 0.5% SGST and 0.5% CGST. Restaurants will be paying tax at the rate of 5%, that is 2.5% SGST and 2.5% CGST. On the screen is an example of calculation of composition tax. Here we have taken example of a manufacturer who has one unit in UP and another unit in MP. The total turnover in the last financial year is 55 lakhs. This figure is important because it has to be below 75 lakhs in the last financial year for the person to become eligible to avail the scheme. In this case, his total turnover is 55 lakhs, 25 plus 30, so he is eligible to composition. Now, turnover in the second quarter of this financial year, let us say, when GST has come into being, is 5 lakhs and 10 lakhs respectively in the state of Uttar Pradesh and Madhya Pradesh. Now, he has to pay tax at the rate of 2%. So, on the turnover of 5 lakhs, he will pay 10,000 rupees, and on the turnover of 10 lakhs, he will pay a tax of 20,000 rupees, being a manufacturer on whom composition rate of 2% is applicable. Now, is composition scheme available to everyone? As I explained, composition scheme has a small exclusion list, and who are the people who are not eligible to composition? Supplier of services in general are not allowed composition, with one exception, and that is a restaurant. Other categories are any person who makes supply of non-GST goods, irrespective of the volume of supply is made. If non-GST supply is made, a smallest amount of non-GST supply will make the person ineligible for composition scheme. Any person who is making interstate supply, that means supplies to other states, supplies to SEZ, exports, all such supplies which are interstate in nature, will make a dealer ineligible for composition scheme. Then supplies which attract tax collection at source. At present, when the procurement is made by the customer through e-commerce operator where the payment is made through e-commerce, then such a dealer who's making the supply through such platform will not be eligible for composition scheme at present. But please note that TCS scheme has not been brought into operation. Section 50 and 51 of CGST have not been notified. At a later date, it will be notified, but this is a general precaution, and therefore I thought that it will be prudent to tell it here. Now, some of the manufacturers have also not been covered in the category of composition scheme. They are ice cream manufacturers, pan masala manufacturers, and any other product of tobacco and manufactured tobacco substitute. Ice cream has been kept in this list because ice cream can be readily manufactured at various places and has a very high value addition. Composition is also not available to a person who is a casual taxable person or a non-resident taxable person because they operate for a very short window of 3 months or 2 months when they visit to do the business. There are certain conditions and restrictions which have to be observed while availing the composition scheme. If at the time of availing composition scheme, there are goods which are purchased from unregistered person, the tax on such goods have to be paid. Second, a composition dealer is not eligible to take ITC input credit. Third, composition dealer, whenever he purchases any goods from an unregistered person, he has to pay tax on reverse charge, and that rate will be merit rate and not composition rate. When a composition dealer buys goods from another composition dealer, please note that this clause in relation to unregistered purchase from unregistered supplier does not apply because both the dealers are registered, and therefore forward charge will apply. Composition dealer is not allowed to collect any amount as tax from the purchaser. There are two, three very important conditions in relation to composition dealer, which essentially flow from this condition that the composition dealer should not be collecting any tax. To protect the consumers, it is important that composition dealer declare that he is a composition taxable person and not eligible to tax on supplies. This is something which he has to declare on the board of his establishment so that the customer is aware. Similarly, when he makes the supply, the document which he issues is not a tax invoice. That document is called bill of supply. Bill of supply will not show the tax element. Bill of supply will only show the total consideration which he is collecting from you. That means if under composition scheme you are buying a pen which is worth 100 rupees, then he will not show the breakup as to what is the value, what is the tax, which under normal circumstances from a non-composition dealer, when you get an invoice, you clearly see what is CGST, what is SGST. Since the composition dealer is out of the credit chain, since the composition dealer is not expected to collect from you the tax at the normal rates, and therefore composition dealer, when he issues a bill of supply, all he shows to you against that supply is the total consideration. He also will show composition taxable person on the notice or signboard displayed at a prominent place in the business. Now, the question arises, what happens to the tax on the goods which a composition dealer has purchased? Means, when he purchases the goods have come tax paid to him, and composition dealer on output side pays tax at a very small rate. So, is there any significant tax advantage? The answer is the composition rates have been so fixed that if you calculate the standard tax rate at the value addition, it will come around the same amount of tax which is being levied. That is to say, For trader, if you calculated the tax payment, if he has purchased tax paid goods, his value addition and profit, and you applied the normal standard tax rate of GST, you will find that the cash component which he would have paid would have been around 1%. But to give him a simplified regime, he is pulled out of the tax credit regime. In lieu, he ends up paying the entire money from cash. Therefore, as far as tax collection is concerned, composition dealer's tax payments are pretty much close to a regular dealer. Minor variations can be there because this is a rounded off rate for all commodities. And from this also flows another significant advantage which a composition dealer has, and that is he does not have to classify each of his supplies in terms of HSN. He has to apply one rate for all commodity, and therefore the classification and the rate which is segregated for each of the supplies in a large departmental store is something which he need not do, because he is likely to be somebody who is a small kirana store in your neighborhood or a mom and pop store. The next is, how do you avail of the composition scheme? It is very important to know that composition scheme is an option. You do not get composition scheme by default. You have to make an application for it online. So when do you make the application and within what time? There are different application forms which are online, and they have to filled in within the time stipulated in the law for you to become eligible for the composition scheme. The first category is a person who was already registered under VAT and Central Excise, and he has undergone migration. On the appointed day, he has got migrated, has received his PID. What does he do? He has to, composition section was notified on 22nd of June. Within 1 month, that is by 21st of July, he has to fill a form called CMP-01. So please note, it is very important for all people eligible under composition scheme, if they wish to avail of composition scheme, please fill in this form CMP-01 by 21st of July. And once you have filled this form, from what date you become eligible, it is not the date from which you have, on date on which you have filled the form. It is from the 1st of July itself, you will become eligible for composition scheme. That means your supplies as of now can be under composition scheme. Now, when a person takes a new registration under GST, when does he opt for composition scheme? In Part B of the intimation of registration form, there is a choice which he has to make. There he should put a tick mark when he is filling the registration form online, and thereafter he will become eligible for the composition scheme. If the application is filed within 30 days of becoming, within 30 days of crossing the threshold, or within 30 days when he wishes to take registration, his date of effective registration is the date on which he has filed the application, and his composition eligibility also arises from the date on which the application was filed. That is also the effective date of registration. That is to say, that composition becomes available not from the date on which the registration certificate is issued to you, but a prior date, which is the effective date as prescribed in the law. In any other case, let us say sometime around middle of the year or from next year onwards, you wish to avail of the composition scheme. Then within what time you should file the application? You should file the application in CMP-02 prior to the next financial year, and the stocks have to be declared 60 days thereafter, that is from the beginning of the financial year. You become then eligible from the beginning of the next financial year. Now, coming to the returns which have to be filed in composition scheme, under composition scheme, tax payment and return filing both are quarterly. That's a simplification measure for people opting for composition scheme, that you don't have to pay your taxes or file your return on a monthly basis. Between 11th to 18th, of the next month. Next month of ending the quarter, that means July, August, September is first quarter, October 11th to 18th. You will file your composition return, and by 18th you will pay your taxes also on the turnover of that quarter. How do you opt out of the composition scheme? As it is an optional scheme, thus you will continue to be eligible to the scheme of the scheme till you fulfill all the conditions which are prescribed for composition scheme. Yet, if your supplies are to manufacturers who want to take credit, and you want to come out of the composition scheme and join the CENVAT credit chain, then you have to again apply the form which has to be filled for coming out of the composition scheme is CMP04. Now, coming to composition return. Composition return is very simple in nature, and it essentially pulls out of the equation two important things. One is input and output credits. Since you are not part of the credit mechanism, therefore, you don't have to maintain credit-related accounts. Similarly, a manufacturer will maintain account in relation to input stocks when it is issued for manufacturing. But a composition dealer does not have to maintain detailed accounts of internal issues and consumptions. He only has to maintain a general account of inputs which are coming and the outputs which are going out, and the turnover and the taxes which are required to be paid. More detail of this I will explain now under the second part of this presentation, that is in relation to accounts and records. Under GST, what are the accounts and records which are required to be maintained? The first thing which I would like to say here is GST allows you to maintain very simple accounts and records. Do not fear the record which are required to be maintained. Most of these you will require to maintain to do your normal business. To do your business, whatever record you maintain, somewhat similar records have been prescribed under GST. And for composition scheme, simplified records can be maintained. The second thing is, you need not maintain all your records electronically only. You are well within your right to maintain your accounts manually, so long as your registers are serially numbered, which anyway most of the businesses do maintain registers in serial number. Section 35 deals with maintenance of accounts and records. A registered person, that is a dealer who's under GST, is required to maintain record and account of inward purchases, then production or manufacture of goods, the stocks issued inside the factory, then stocks which are lost within the factory because of various kinds of losses which may take place. Then, since a normal taxpayer will avail of the credit account has to be maintained of all the inputs which have come, credit of input services as well as credit of capital goods. All these go in input tax credit account. Then on the supplies which are being made, that is outward output supplies, what is the total tax liability? That account has to be maintained, which you also will need to calculate to discharge your tax liability. Advance payments received, taxes payable thereon will be calculated under normal circumstances, and if these and how these advances at a later date get adjusted towards the supplies against which these advances have been received. A composition dealer has to maintain simpler records, which, as I explained, does not have two elements, that is input tax credit element and the issue of inputs for manufacturing process, etc. Now, there are certain other categories of people also to whom some records have been prescribed under GST, namely warehouse, godown operator, transporter, even when he is not registered. So what are the records which he has to maintain? For example, transporter, to whom he is sending the goods, from whom he is receiving the goods. It's a normal record which he will otherwise also maintain to carry out his business. if they are registered their GSTN numbers, so that if there is a need, it can be checked. Then place of delivery, delivery challan, movement record. These are general records which otherwise also a transporter maintains. Now an agent to a principal is also required to maintain record of the receipts and supply which he makes on behalf of the principal, and the record of authorization, which means that if an agent is an agent of multiple principal, he will need to maintain accounts principal wise so that it can be correlated as to which, against which principal, how much supply he is making as an agent. A CNF agent or a carrier having custody of the goods on behalf of a registered person is also required to maintain record. It is fairly similar to record which is to be maintained by a transporter. As I have already explained, it is not necessary that you maintain your account electronically. You can maintain your account manually also. Records in relation, if you have multiple business premises, then record in relation to each of the business premises has to be kept at individual business premises. But if this presents problem for you, an easier option is these records, which can also be maintained electronically, should have access to the record, electronic record from various places of business, and therefore it becomes that much easier if you are opting for electronic record keeping if you have multiple business premises, large operation. So long as the access to the record is from available from each of the account, you would be considered to have satisfied this condition of record being maintained at each places individually. Now, how long should you maintain this record? In GST, there is a period of limitation prescribed in the law within which if any duty or tax is to be demanded, which can be demanded, the period for which the records are to be maintained has been linked to that period. It is 6 years from the due date of filing of the annual return. That is for the any given financial year. Next December 31st is the date by which you have to file your annual return. So you go back 6 years and then calculate as to how long you have to maintain the record. Now sometimes it may happen that the records which have been prescribed in a standard manner to be maintained are either not adequate or it is not possible to maintain it in the manner which has been prescribed. Law provides for solutions to both these situations. The commissioners in the state have been empowered, as well as the central CGST commissioners, that should there be a need, they can prescribe additional records which are required to be maintained by a dealer. And also, if certain relaxations are required to be given, law provides that if you find that the current record maintenance regime prescribed is not adequate, is proving to be cumbersome, relaxation can be provided. Now, as far as works contract is concerned, works contract record is required to be maintained for each of the works contract. That is, how much of inputs you have received, how much of works contract you are doing, what is your output in relation to work, each of the works contract, and what are the payments which you have received in relation to each of the works contract. As it applies to all tax laws, if the records which you are maintaining have to be produced to the tax officer if it is so demanded. Otherwise, it is enough to maintain the record with yourself. Now, if your turnover crosses 2 crores, then you have to get your account audited by a chartered accountant, and a reconciliation statement in the form of annual return is also required to be filed, which is basically reconciliation between your financial records and the tax returns which you have filed. The copy of the audited annual account and the reconciliation statement is required to be filed for those having turnover above 2 crore. In case you have opted to maintain your accounts electronically, the account has to be digitally signed and authenticated. It has to be preserved and maintained in such a manner that it can be restored within reasonable time if it is lost or damaged. That means recovery provisions should be there. And if you are using passwords and protections, then should a tax officer demand, you have to make that available along with sample of the record so that necessary verification can be carried out. So now I'll request RS sir to take questions.
Okay, we'll take up the frequently asked questions one by one. Quite a few have been received from social media, and many have already been answered via the presentation, so we will skip some of them, and some of them may require reiteration by the officers. I have three units, all in different states. Do I need to furnish the intimation for opting for composition for each of these units separately? Would you like to reiterate?
Sir, composition, as I explained, if you have applied for one unit, it is deemed that you have made application for all the units. You need not apply for all the three units individually. And your turnover will be calculated on the basis of total turnover of the three units, and application for one shall be application for all. You do not have the choice of taking composition for any of these units. Composition has to be taken for all three.
I have a small petrol pump. I also sell grocery item from the same premises. The GST officer in my area has informed me that I am not eligible for composition scheme, even though my total turnover was less than 75 lakh rupees in previous financial year. Is he right?
Clarification given is correct, because as of now, petrol is a non-taxable product as far as GST is concerned, and therefore anything that is non-taxable, it would not be liable for composition scheme, because you cannot legally charge tax on something which is non-taxable. Therefore, composition will not be available in such a situation.
If I opt for composition scheme, will I not be allowed input tax credit of that I pay on supplies which I receive from unregistered person? Would you like to reiterate?
Since you are not eligible to take input tax credit and to collect tax, therefore, from unregistered dealer, once you buy goods, you have to pay tax, but you will not be eligible to take input tax credit on them.
Can a registered person opt for composition only for one out of his three units? The answer is no. Will composition scheme be disallowed even if a person makes occasional interstate supply?
No. Under composition scheme, interstate supply is barred. So even if you make one interstate supply, you will not be eligible to avail of composition scheme. So please maintain this precaution of not making interstate supplies. But our regular scheme outside the composition is also very simple in GST. And if you have such supplies, opt out of composition scheme. And our regular scheme is also very easy to follow. Then you can follow that scheme.
Actually, I want to say that the composition scheme is only mainly for people who are having B2C business, retailing, within the state only. It is not meant for people who are doing interstate supplies and those who are, of course, you can take composition for B2B supply also. But normally when you have to sell your goods to somebody who is doing business, he will require input tax credit. So they will not prefer to buy from composition dealers. So composition scheme is mainly for B2C people, and that also within the state. If you want to do business outside the state, or if you want to do business B2B, then we would advise you to kindly go in for a regular registration. And there also it is not difficult. Suppose, I mean, of course, in composition, one benefit you get is that you have to file your return once in 3 months and pay tax at a nominal rate after 3 months only. While if you are a regular registered dealer, every month you have to file your return and pay the tax every month. That is the only difference. But in case of B2C dealers whose turnover is above 75 lakhs and who are regularly registered under GST, there also the B2C dealers don't have to give item-wise, invoice-wise detail in the return. Even if their turnover is 10 crore, 15 crore, 20 crore, they have to only file the details of total supplies, item rate wise, 5% wali item, how much of item of 5% you have sold, 12%. So they have to give the total supply details in the return, GSTR 1. So it is fairly simple even in the case of normal registered dealer. So one can always opt for a regular scheme rather than composition.
You've just answered the next question, that can a registered person who buys from a person under composition levy claim input tax credit of composition tax? You've just said he can't. A registered taxable person was paying tax under composition rate up to 30th November. However, with effect from 1st December 2017, he becomes liable to pay tax under regular scheme. Is he eligible for input tax credit?
You want to give? You want to give? Okay.
See, once he comes out of composition scheme, thereafter he will become eligible, but not for the period during which he was within the composition scheme. Once he comes out of the composition scheme, he has to file a declaration of the stock, and the inputs contained therein will be, there is a procedure by which you can, on that much of stock, because those will be used for making supplies post coming out of the composition scheme, to that extent credit will become available.
Again, I would like to expand on this. Whenever, suppose you think that your turnover will be below 75 lakhs per annum, you start with a composition scheme, but you find that by December, 75 lakhs you already reached. So as soon as you reach 75 lakhs, immediately you have to opt for a regular scheme, and then you have to go in for that. At that time, this transition is being allowed. So any stock which is left unsold as on the date of transition to regular registration, you can take input tax credit for that. The second thing, which again very important point, is that anybody, if he registers to begin with as a regular registered person, in between he thinks that no, my turnover is going to be less than 75 lakhs. So during the year he cannot opt for a composition. He will have to wait till the year is over. He can opt for composition only in the next year. So once you are registered, halfway through the year, if you find that you are probably going to be eligible for composition, so you can't change your option middle of the year. You have to wait for 1st of April to come, and then you can opt for that scheme.
Okay. Yeah. So from this, what Honorable RS said, an important precaution for you is, please make an assessment as to whether in this year you would want to avail of the composition scheme or not. And if you so wish, please apply for composition scheme if you are a migrated dealer by 21st of July.
I am a job worker. Am I eligible for compensation scheme?
Yes. Job work under GST is a provision of service. Service providers are not eligible for composition scheme except restaurants. Therefore, if you are a job worker, you will not be able to take composition.
No service provider other than restaurant are eligible under the composition scheme. So if you are a professional, if you are having consultancy income, then above 20 lakhs, you have to register as a regular taxpayer. Service tax, in case of service tax, composition scheme is not applicable except in case of restaurant.
So it's related to restaurant, the next one, though it has been answered already in the presentation. I run a restaurant. I also manufacture ice cream in small quantity. Am I eligible for compensation scheme?
No.
The answer is no. Let's move on to some questions that have come from Twitter specifically. And they are that if we have stock on 30th June, which is purchased from another state, can we opt for composition in GST after paying GST?
As of now, no. Unfortunately, the provision of the rule is made in such a way that if you've got a stock which is lying with you, which is bought from interstate purchase, because you only paid CST on it. So because your stock is not tax paid, you cannot opt for composition as per the present rules.
Saurabh has asked on Twitter, when can we apply for enrollment into compensation scheme for dealers? When will link for compensation scheme start working on registrations? Would you like to reiterate?
It is already working on the portal, so you can go and apply for composition scheme.
Those people who have transited, they should invariably do it by 22nd of July, because the scheme was notified on 22nd of June. So within 30 days, you are supposed to give your option. So those who have transited from old tax number to, say, from VAT to GST, they have to give their option by 22nd July only. So we would again emphasize on this. For people who are newly registered, they will get time, they have to give this option at the time of registration. So that is also available. Both the options are available online. So for people who are migrated also, you can give that option today itself. It is available online. The form number CMP01. And for newly registered people, it is already a part of the form. So that it, there itself you have to tick mark that I want to go for composition.
Ram Kishore Sharma has asked on Twitter, I am a composition dealer. Do I have to pay 1% tax even on GST exempt items?
Composition actually is payable on total turnover. It does not make a distinction between what is the nature of your supply, whether it is exempt, which is whether it is taxed at 12% or 18%. Exempt supplies, goods which are otherwise exempt, even if supplied under composition scheme, will form part of total turnover on which composition tax will be calculated.
I wish to avail compensation scheme. However, I have so far not been able to furnish the intimation. Can I make a supply?
Yes, you can make a supply, but so long as you file your intimation for composition scheme within the stipulated date, during this period also you will issue bill of supply.
There's a related question. Once I opt for compensation scheme, will I be required to file intimation every year? This has been covered in the presentation though.
No.
But would you like to reiterate?
No. You become eligible for composition and thereafter you continue to be in the scheme so long as you fulfill all the conditions which are prescribed in the law for the same.
I have migrated to GST. I wish to opt for compensation scheme. I have certain input tax credit in my VAT return. What will happen to such input tax credit? The trader has migrated to GST and he had a certain input tax credit in his VAT return. He wants to know what will happen to such ITC. He wants to opt for the composition scheme.
No. Since in composition you are outside the credit chain, therefore any credit which was there in your account will also lapse.
Some questions have come in on social media on accounts and records. Is it necessary to maintain all records electronically in GST? You've answered that. Would you like to reiterate?
You can maintain your accounts manually also if it is convenient to you. The registers should be serially numbered. That's the only requirement prescribed in the law.
Do transporter or clearing and forwarding agents or warehouse keepers who are not registered under GST require to maintain any records?
Yes, there are certain basic records which have been prescribed, which I explained during the presentation. It is basically where the goods are coming from, where the goods are going, registration number of them, and when the goods have come and when the goods have gone. It is basically to complete this picture. Certain records have been prescribed, which are otherwise also maintained by any transporter or warehouse keeper to run his business efficiently.
How long are the records required to be preserved under GST? Would you like to reiterate?
6 years is the time from the annual return. One particular situation which is a proviso is that if there is a litigation on a particular kind of issue, then records relating to those have to be maintained till the litigation is going on.
If there are any questions from the floor, the mic may be passed, but in the meantime, one question has just come in on Twitter. Kishore Kshatriya has asked, looks strange. One can't opt composition levy if his closing stock includes interstate purchases. Why can't he be asked to pay VAT?
I explained this could have been done, but the rules have already been formulated, which says you can't do it. We'll see if in future we can change the rule and do something about it. But this is one issue which has come to my notice, wherein the prohibition is there. It could have been made possible that subject to payment of tax on goods purchased on interstate, we could have made them eligible, but we'll look into it.
Any questions from the floor?
YouTuber and bloggers earn money from the blog and YouTube on advertisement. Google pay it from Singapore in US dollar. Is it under GST?
B2C is under GST and it was also under service tax. When you are I am presuming that you are suggesting that you are downloading contents from internet, which is B2C.
No, I'll explain.
And
I understand his question. What you are saying is, suppose an Indian person views advertisement on the website of these global companies, then what happens? Because they don't have a place of business here. But under the GST law, we have made it mandatory for them also to pay taxes on this. You know, so they will have to, even in case of B2C, of course, advertisement is normally given by B2B people. So in case of B2B, in reverse charge, they can pay. But even in case of B2C, we have mandated that they should keep a representative in India who will make all this payment of taxes. So on items which are downloadable, on which they are charging, there would be GST on that. Okay.
Any other question from the floor?
But in Google India, this is on AdSense. If I want to advertise on Google or YouTube, I would pay to Google India, and that is also included in service tax or GST, and they pay to government. But an advertisement, if I earn from the YouTube advertisement, Google directly pay in US dollar to my account, not to the Indian service recipients.
Talking about some complicated case. The idea is that one time tax will apply.
There is two transactions, sir, in
no,
this
two
case.
Different transactions, then you are talking about something else. You know, you will have to give us all the details. Then only we can respond to it.
You can send us your detailed question along with facts on the mail. We will respond to you formally.
Okay. The GST is not applicable for the registration purpose. Turnover is 20 lakh below.
The kind of transaction you're mentioning is complicated. We'll have to understand before we give reaction to that.
Okay.
Okay.
Sir, you mentioned that one has to keep the records for 6 years. Suppose a person, his document get destroyed or he lost the document, then what will happen?
I don't know. There are provisions in every law for that, you know, handling that. But first of all, if it is stolen or destroyed, you will have to make a police complaint. Then you will have to inform the tax authority. That would be the normal procedure, I suppose, isn't it?
And in case you are maintaining electronic record, you are expected to maintain a backup. The law expects you to maintain a backup.
Okay.
So there are some questions that are not related to compensation, to this composition, but if you permit, we can take them up. One is that input tax credit in case of jewelry sector where the GST is at 3%, how could the same be calculated where documents are mostly unavailable?
Documents are unavailable? No, if documents on the purchase side, well, I think usme to we are not any deemed supplier, deemed adjusting, no?
No, sir. No. If one of the condition of availing credit is that the document evidencing payment of tax should be available and tax should have been paid. If for some reason it is not available, then credit cannot be availed. And for any value-added tax to work, input tax credit can only be made available on a verifiable document prescribed in law. So if it is not available, credit will also not be available.
In grocery stores, sale varies from 10 rupees to 500 rupees per order. Do I require to issue tax invoice on every sale of more than 200 rupees?
Yes, yesterday we discussed the invoice rule. If it is more than 200 rupees, then you have to. And if you are not a composition dealer, if you are having a grocery store, then and not in the composition scheme, so your turnover is more than 75 lakhs. Then you are supposed to give a bill of invoice, not the bill of supply, but invoice. And invoice has to have the detail of CGST, SGST for every item above 200 rupees. And even below 200 rupees, if the customer insists, then you have to give a bill. Okay.
If I'm dealing in non-taxable items with interstate supply, then I have to be registered or not? Interstate supply, there has to be registration.
Yes, yes. For making any interstate supply, you have to be registered. But if you are dealing only in non-taxable goods, then no. Suppose if you are dealing only in wheat or rice, you know, on which there is no tax, or you are supplying milk all over the country, milk also there is no tax, then of course you don't have to take registration, right?
Correct. Same will apply for goods which are outside the
GST. So if you are only doing the trade of petrol and diesel, which are not part of GST, then you don't have to take GST registration.
Abhay Verma has asked on Twitter, can an employee who is not registered as authorized signatory sign the tax invoice under GST? If not, how to include?
It is only the authorized signatory who has to sign. He has to make amendment in the application of registration to show as to who is the authorized. That amendment is allowed to the company in the normal process. He can suggest as to who will be signing.
Yesterday or day before, I think we explained in the registration process that in the registration form, there are core fields and there are non-core fields. So there are only three core fields which cannot be changed by you yourself. But authorized signatory is something which is a non-core field. So a person himself can go online and change his authorized signatory any number of times he wants to do it.
Is embroidery, a job work done on client's fabric, considered as a supply of goods or supply of service? What? Embroidery, job work done on client's fabric, considered as supply of goods or supply of service?
No. This is a service which is being done because the fabric has been supplied by the client on which embroidery is being done. So it is a provision of service.
And if you are buying cloth yourself and doing some embroidery on it, that is something like manufacturing, you know, it's not a service then. In which case the rule of composite supply will apply, the predominant items rate will apply. So for example, the cloth value is 100 rupees and the value of embroidering is 10 rupees, then it will be, of course, the cloth value which will apply.
How to adjust advance received and GST paid in it in the invoice issued at the time of supply? How to adjust advance received and GST paid in it in the invoice issued at the time of supply?
Adjustment of the advances have to be reflected both in invoice as well as in the return. There are fields provided for it. You will be able to do it. In the return also, you have to accordingly show it.
No, what he is asking is that suppose he gets an advance. So at that time, he will have to make a receipt for advance on which the tax will be payable in the same month when he receives the advance. And he will have to account for it in the next month's return and do it. The supply is going next month, and then he's getting the full remaining payment. So that time also, again, he will have to charge
invoice for the balance amount.
He'll have to charge. And then, so the client will get receipt of advance payment on which tax is paid, and also the invoice for the remaining amount. So the client will also be able to take the input tax credit for that.
Yes, at both the stages.
Yeah.
If an entity has not registered under service tax for export in June, can they claim service tax on inputs as of now?
Export? What is the situation?
If an entity has not registered under service tax for exports in June, can they claim service tax on inputs now?
No.
No. He has to take the registration now, and from the effective date of the registration, if it's a new registration case, from the effective date of the registration, subsequent to the effective date, whatever supplies have been received, both of input and input services, credit will be available, but not of period prior to that. Otherwise, also, this question is regarding supplies which have been received in the month of June. In the month of June, GST was not applicable. So if those credits are not in your last return of June, they will not be available under GST.
Credit?
Transition doesn't apply for services.
Will credit of input tax paid in case of exports be available if the shipment mode is courier or post?
Shipment?
Mode is courier or post.
So you want to say refund?
Credit of input tax paid in case of exports be available?
No, in case of export, of course, if you are exporting anything, you are subject to complete refund of all the taxes paid on the inputs, you know.
Yes, it is mode neutral, including the export by whatever modes he is prescribing, irrespective of that. So long as
it is not subject to any mode of this thing, whether you export by ship, by air, by courier, whatever method you export, it has nothing to do. The export is zero rated, which means there will be complete refund of all inputs taxes which are paid.
In case of service industry, how do we show expense incurred on pure agent basis in our sales invoice?
paid on?
In case of service industry, how do we show expense incurred on pure agent basis in our sales invoice?
It has to be part of the total supply value, no?
No, sir. Pure agent is a situation wherein there are 7-8 conditions which have to be met. And if all those 7-8 conditions are met, then the value is to be separately shown. The taxable and this pure agent value will come separately in the invoice.
One last question. Do jewelers need to reverse charge on old gold purchased from a retail customer? Old gold purchased from a retail customer.
Old goods.
Old gold.
Old gold.
Purchased from a retail customer. Do jewelers need to reverse charge on that?
No, there will be. Of course, there will be. But at the same time, he'll give input tax credit. He'll get input tax credit of it. So what you are saying is, if I'm a jeweler, somebody comes to me with a piece of old jewelry, then it is as good as my buying gold from him. So isn't it? You are buying from unregistered person gold, and then you are making jewelry out of it, and you are selling it. So you can take input tax credit of it after paying reverse charge.
Yes, sir.
Isn't it?
For used goods, there is an exception.
No. That is not there. Not for this particular thing. If you are a registered dealer, and if you are buying something, I'm not buying old jewelry, I'm buying old gold, piece of gold only. That old jewelry is going to be melted. So I'm buying a piece of gold on which I have to pay GST. I can take input tax credit of it when I sell the jewelry.
All right, that's all the time that we have for this session. Thank you, Mr. Adhia, Mr. Priya, and Mr. Sinha for having joined us. Thank you all for having joined us. That's all that we have for you in this masterclass on composition and record keeping. Thanks for watching.